Father, we come to you this morning, Lord, because we can. Because you invite us, you welcome us to come boldly before your throne, Lord. To have fellowship with you, to be with you. To learn of you, Lord Jesus. To learn who you are. To know of your love for us, your mercy and your grace. And Lord, we pray this morning, Lord, that as always, as we open your word this morning, Lord, that your word would open our hearts. And draw us nearer to you, Lord Jesus, that you would teach us, that you would nurture us, that you would nourish us. And Lord, as we go from here, that you would use us, Lord, to be that light and that salt, to draw others to you, Lord Jesus, that they may know the same Lord and Savior that we do, that they may find your peace and your glory and your hope. In your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. All right, if you will, open your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. So we're moving along through the book of 1 Corinthians rather quickly here. We talked about with it last week as Paul through chapter 5 there deals with the immorality within the church and gives us examples of things and how we should deal with it and how our dealing with immorality in the church should be different than our dealing with immorality outside of the church. The bottom line of it is that we should expect unbelievers to act like unbelievers, shouldn't we? Yeah? It doesn't surprise us when they do things that are ungodly, because they do not possess the ability to do godly things. They may do a right thing from time to time. And the other side of that is that we ought to expect Christians, believers in the church, to act like Christians, shouldn't we? To do godly things, to live a life pleasing to the Lord, desiring to be pleasing to the Lord. Coming alongside one another, lifting each other up, and growing each other up in the Lord, and dealing with the things within and not so much without. Oftentimes it happens in churches and Christians and everything, they get so wrapped up and concerned about what's going on out there that they don't pay any attention to what's going on in here. And it all comes back and it all starts with what's going on in here, in our own hearts, and having those settled on the Lord. Paul says to deal with these things, but to deal with them in a loving and gracious manner. And not to set ourselves apart from the world and to be not of the world, but in the world. It's like trying to use a flashlight in the daytime. You can do it, but it doesn't work real well. It's much more effective at night. So don't set yourself apart from the people out there in the world, because they need to see the light and the love of Christ. He talked about purifying the body of Christ, that we should be an unleavened lump. And the best way to be purified is to be purified by Christ and having fellowship with Him, being in His Word. Chapter 6, verse 1. He shifts into a little bit of a different subject here, answering the questions of the things that were going on at the church here. He says, "Dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to law before the unrighteous and not before the saints? Do you not know that the saints will judge the world? And if the world will be judged by you, are you unworthy to judge the smallest matters? Do you not know that we shall judge angels? How much more things that pertain to this life? Then if you have judgments concerning things pertaining to this life, do not appoint those who are least esteemed by the church to judge. I say this to your shame. Is it so that there is not a wise man among you, not even one, who will be able to judge between his brethren? But brother goes to law against brother, and that before unbelievers. Now, therefore, it is already an utter failure for you that you go to law against one another. Why do you not rather accept wrong? Why do you not rather let yourselves be cheated? Do you yourselves do wrong? Or let me read that again. Verse 8. No, you yourselves do wrong and cheat, and you do these things to your brethren. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you, but you were washed, but you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. Paul lays this out there to the church here and some of the things that they're doing, their practices, the issues that come up between brothers and sisters in the church, between the church family, are being dealt with, being taken to court before the unsaved judges, like going to Judge Joe, right? Or Judge Judy, you know, taking the things of that's happening within the church and within believers and going to the courts of the unrighteous to get these things settled. He says, dare any of you having a matter against another go to law before the unrighteous and not before the saints? Why would we take it to them when it's to be dealt with between us, brothers and sisters in Christ? We have issues, we enter into things, we have agreements, we work deals and stuff like that with one another, even believers doing business with other believers and stuff, and sometimes things don't always run smoothly. And sometimes there are situations that need to be addressed and need to be dealt with, where there needs to be somebody who's not in the middle of it to sit down and say, okay, let's hear this side, let's hear this side, and then let's go to the Word of God and see what the principles of God, what the Lord would do. What would Jesus do? What would He have us do? And what's a righteous answer here? We get caught up in these things, and a good part of it is that we want to be proved right. And it becomes an issue about who's right, not what is right. And it shouldn't be that way. And we take these things as a church, believers, and go before the unrighteous. How can you get a righteous ruling from an unrighteous person? How can that judge, that magistrate, that unbelieving person seek the will of God in this situation? Can you expect to go to the courthouse and have the judge bring both parties up before his whatever you call it there, up in front of him, and say, all right, let's start with prayer? Wow, that'd be something, wouldn't it? It'd be good if it happened. If they were believers, you know, that'd be great. But it doesn't often happen that way. It says you go before them and not before the saints, not bringing it to those who have the mind of Christ, not bringing it before those who have the Holy Spirit dwelling in them, not bringing it before those who can truly seek the will of God in this particular situation, taking it to someone else. Verse 2, he says, do you not know that the saints will judge the world? And if the world will be judged by you, are you unworthy to judge the smallest of matters? Talks about the saints judging the world. He's talking about the time in the millennial reign with Christ. Look, if you will, real quickly over into Revelation chapter 20. We'll catch a peek at it. He says, and I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was committed to them. Then I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for their witness to Jesus and for the Word of God, who had not worshipped the beast or his image, and there had not received the mark on their foreheads and on their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. Talks about us and them the tribulation saints coming and living and reigning with Christ. We're going to have a position in there of judging things, of ruling things. Some way, somehow, however, that's all going to work out. You're going to be, you know, be the sheriff over here in this town or something. I don't know. He's talking about us coming as believers and looking forward to what the Lord's going to do in our lives. And if we have that, the mind of Christ, can't we even deal with the small things now? If He's working in us so that we can judge the world in this sense, what about the things now? It'll be different then than it is now, but what about these things? What about the temporal things that are going on around us? He says the smallest things, the smallest matters. Are you unworthy to judge them? Sometimes it can be hard to look around and see the people that we know, even the believers, and say, who do I want to sit down with? And yet if we look around and we truly see the lives of those, there are many of us that have the wisdom of God, where we can sit down and say, hey, would you mind mediating? Can we come together in this? The elders of the church, the leadership, to bring that to them and say, hey, we've got an issue going here, and rather than cause division, rather than cause strife, rather than cause harm to one another, can we bring this together and decide it here? We remember that Jesus talked about one sinning against another, to go to them and talk to them, try and settle it yourself. That doesn't work. Get a couple other people, try to settle it then. If that doesn't work, then bring it to the church and let us decide. Let us work it out. Let us seek God's will in this matter and settle it between us. The idea here is keep it in the family, so to speak. You all know how that works, don't you? There's stuff that happens sometimes in families and everything like that. We're like, man, I hope the neighbors didn't hear that. Keep it in the family. I have a guy that I've known for quite some time, a believer and everything, and we happened to work together at the time, and he was having a conversation with one of the other guys that worked there. The three of us were there, and he was having this conversation with this other guy that didn't work there, this other man that was an unbeliever, and he started talking bad about another person, another sister, a Christian. And the unbeliever says, well, isn't she a Christian too? As he kind of railed on her a little bit. And after that was all done and the other guy left and everything, I said, kind of called him on it. I said, man, shouldn't that be kept between us? Shouldn't that be dealt with in the family as believers? You know, none of us go to the same church, but we're all in the family. We're all in the body of Christ. And how does it look to him, the unbeliever, to see Christians going after one another that way? You know? And he just kind of, oh, man. And he, you know, he was sorry, but he didn't think about it. We don't always think about this. He was looking at it as this is a workplace issue. But when you go to work, do you stop being part of the body of Christ? Do other believers that might be in the workplace with you, are because they don't fellowship with you at your church, does that mean that they're not part of the body of Christ? Does the fact that it's a work issue make it any different? The way that we should treat brothers and sisters? He goes in there and he's dealing with this and judging it before those in the world. Verse 3 says, do you not know that we shall judge angels, and how much more the things that pertain to this life? 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4, it talks about judging angels, the fallen angels and that. There's going to be some role that we have in that. He's saying, the Lord's working in you to do this. You have the Holy Spirit dwelling in you. You look at this, well, we're going to judge the world, we're going to reign, and we're going to rule with Christ, and we're going to have some judgment over the angels and all that stuff like that. But can't you handle the things that are going on in day-to-day life with one another? When there's a dispute, when there's a disagreement, when there's a problem with one another, why are you taking it to the judges? Verse 4, he says, if then you have judgments concerning things pertaining to this life, do you appoint those who are least esteemed by the church to judge? Interesting little experiment you can do sometime. Probably want to keep it within the body. Sit down with a group of believers and ask them what they think about the Supreme Court justices. You really want to go there? You get all kinds of stuff, don't you? We look at that, we see that the people, we see our government and the judicial system in this country and everything, and we as believers are very quick to recognize the injustice that goes on out there, aren't we? We're very quick to recognize the unrighteousness and the corruption that's in the establishment around us. We see that because we can see it. The world, the unbelievers may not always see it. They may have different opinions for different reasons and all that, but we see, we understand because we know the real judge, Jesus Christ. We know His heart. We know His love. We understand grace and mercy more so than any unbeliever could because we've received that from Him. We have a just example in Jesus Christ, in the Lord. We know what justice is, don't we? We understand that. We understand righteousness because of the righteous example that we have in the Lord. And for us as believers, seeing those things, we know that the world out there is corrupt and that these that the world puts in those places as judges can oftentimes be very corrupt. Not all of them. Some of them are okay. There's even believers out there in those positions that do the best they can to stand for true righteousness, true justice, to do that in a godly way. But those out there, those judges, those of that corrupt world system and everything, he's saying, why do you want to appoint them to have judgment over these matters that are just temporal, earthly things? Why do you want them to have judgment over these matters when they are the least esteemed of the church? And that being least esteemed is that we really don't value what they're doing. Not that we don't value them as people, but what they're doing. We understand the ways of the world and who the God of this world is. Why would you want to go to them to settle an issue between brothers? We enter into agreements with one another. There's Christian business people that have work, that do jobs and various different things, have businesses that they do. And it's always nice when we need something that they do, that they provide, that we can go to them and say, hey, I want to support you and your business because you're a brother. Then it's great. You go through phone books. Why do I keep thinking about phone books? Anybody got a phone book? Is it holding something up somewhere in a corner of your house somewhere? You know? It used to be, you can probably see online now, it used to be you go to the phone book and you look for the little fish symbol in there on somebody's advertisement. You see that and you go, oh man, maybe I'll start with these people. Knowing that they were believers, or at least claiming to be, and it's great to support other believers in their business. But it doesn't always work out quite right. A couple of years back, called up a guy, brother, believer, works for one of the automotive places in town. I called him up and said, hey, I'm looking for some parts for something. And it struck me as odd, or unfortunate, I guess. And I knew not to take it personally, but it struck me as unfortunate that one of the things that he felt the necessity to tell me was that this is a business, and just because we're brothers doesn't mean that I can give you a better deal than anybody else. And I went, wow. You know, and that's not why I called him. I called him because I knew he knew what he was doing, you know, and everything. And I get that, you know. But how unfortunate it is that somebody would have to make a statement like that. Because too often we as brothers and sisters, as believers, we call somebody that has their business as a Christian and everything. Well, I'm going to call the Christian and say, hey, I'm a Christian too, man. Can I get the godly discount there? Can you work me a deal, brother? You slide me something under the table over here. You know, we're looking for something for nothing here. I want to call. I want to get this done by a Christian, by a believer, by a brother. But I want it cheap. Yeah. And sometimes, if we can, we have the liberty to do those things, and it's not bad when it happens and everything. But if you're dealing with something like that, and you call them up, and they're a believer and everything like that, and they're doing a business, you should expect and be willing to pay whatever price it would be for anybody else, wouldn't you? Maybe slip them a little extra because they're a believer. I don't know. But too oftentimes, the necessity is there for someone to make that kind of a statement. I know we're believers and everything, but this is a business, and I gotta charge what I gotta charge. And we ought not to expect anything different. The other side of that coin is oftentimes we get somebody that's got the business, that's doing the work and everything. Yeah, I'll come and do that for you. And they find out that the person that's hiring them is a believer and everything. Oh, yeah, that's great. I'll come and do this for you. You know, and they kind of cut corners. The work's not there and everything. They put it off. They drag it out and everything. And, oh, you know, brother, thank you for being gracious with me. Thank you for your patience and all this stuff like this. And they do less the job in an inferior way than what they would with somebody else. You know? I guess in a sense it's kind of good that if they're going to be a goofball, do it with believers maybe, than those out there in the world when they got that little fish on their business card. But sometimes the businessman takes advantage of that. You know? Oh, I know this brother, this sister, and you know, and everything, and they know I'm struggling and everything, so you know, they would want to help me out, so I'll charge them a little bit more. And things happen. And unfortunately, we deal with the same thing that Paul's dealing with here. Sometimes in business, even as believers, we take advantage of one another. Start looking for something for nothing. Or looking for more from someone than we would somebody else. Or not doing the job the way that we would. In other ways, oh, you're a brother, he'll understand, it'll be all right. Instead of just doing a straight up honest business with everyone the same way. And because of this, we end up going to court with one another. Instead of bringing it to the church, bringing it to the righteous judges. Taking it to those out there in the world. And the world sees that. If you don't think they pay attention, they do. Yeah, I brought my brother here to court, Judge Joe, because he cheated me on this. Well, brother so-and-so didn't want to do this, so I didn't do that. And you get the whole thing, all this dirty laundry, if you will, out there in front of the unbelievers. And what do you think they think? What happened to Christians loving one another? You see, because they know that. They know we're supposed to. They know we're not supposed to quarrel and do all those things and act like everybody else out there in the world. And that unbelieving judge looks at us as believers and just goes, you guys are a mess. Because they brought these things together. Verse 5. I say this to your shame. Is it so that there is not a wise man among you, not even one, who will be able to judge between his brethren? He says this to their shame. He's telling them, you know, look around. Isn't there somebody within the church that you could bring this to? Isn't there a wise man? Isn't there somebody that you can trust? Somebody that you would think could bring a good godly judgment in these things? There ought to be. As believers, as Christians, as we come together around the Word of God, we ought to be grown up enough, mature enough as believers to handle things without letting our emotions and stuff get in the way, to be that mediator between two people, to take both sides and consider them. He's talking to the people that are going to court out there. to their shame. And he's kind of saying, well, didn't you look around in your church? Isn't there anybody over there that you could have taken it to that has the wisdom to do this? We look around and we see fellow believers that have a good, strong walk with the Lord, that display consistently the fruit of the Spirit in their lives, that show in their own lives, in their own walks, the wisdom of God working in their lives. And say, hey, you know what, brother, we've missed something here. Somehow we're butting heads over here and it's not good. Let's go get somebody that's going to seek the will of God in here to help us out, to bring us to the point of truth so that we can work this out. Somebody that's not going to say, well, you know what, you're my buddy over here and we go hanging out together all the time and stuff, so I'm going to judge this on your side. Somebody that says, I don't care who's right, I care what's right. People in the church, Christians ought to be able to be that way, shouldn't they? One of the things that you get in relationships within the church, husbands and wives, is that whole idea about who's right, who's wrong. You know, I like to be right. And I found that the best way for me to be right, for the most part, is to stick right with what the Word of God says, to be based on this, to seek His will and His righteousness. Because He's right to line up with the Word of God. And you get in those situations where you're the one that they've come to. And you got to put everything else aside and say, you know what, let's come to the Word of God. Let's come to the Lord. Let's seek the Lord's will in this. And what He says is right. As believers in any relationship, from marriage relationships to whatever, the best thing that you can do when there's some difference of opinion is say, you know what, let's see what the Word of God says on this. Let's come together and find out what's right. And as believers, that should be our greatest desire, shouldn't it? Not to prove who's right, but to see what's right according to the Word of God. And that way you have to get rid of your pride, don't you? Like I said, we all like to be right. And most of us like other people to know that we're right, don't we? And the hardest thing for us to do is to sit it down and say, let somebody else be wrong. But when there's these disagreements and these things, don't go outside to the unrighteous. Come to the brethren. Surely there's somebody around, some wise man, somebody that can help you find the will of God in these things. Bring it to the church, not to the court out there. Verse 6. But brother goes to law against brother, and that before unbelievers. Again, how can you expect an unbeliever to pass a righteous judgment between brothers? Verse 7. But brother goes to law against brother, and that before unbelievers. Now therefore, it is already an utter failure for you that you go to law against one another. Why do you not rather accept wrong? Why do you not rather let yourselves be cheated? The idea here is not to just let everybody take advantage of you and not do anything about it, but the idea here is, rather than going and taking the things out to the judges out there, taking it out to the world, wouldn't it be better to just let it be than to take this before some unbelieving, unrighteous person to pass judgment on your situation? Wouldn't it be better to just let it go? Sometimes it is better to just let it go. Sometimes it's not worth it. Weigh it out carefully. Is this worth dealing with, or is it just, yeah, you know, whatever? Is it worth it? Certainly not worth going out there before the unbelievers. He says it's already a failure that you go to law, that you go out to the world. It's already a failure. You're not going to get what you're looking for there. Look over in Matthew chapter 5 with me. I'm going to start in verse 38, so we remember our context here a little bit. You have heard it said, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you not to resist an evil person, but whoever slaps you on the right cheek, turn the other to him also. Verse 40, if anyone wants to sue you and take away your tunic, let him have your cloak also. And whoever compels you to go 1 mile, go with him too. Give to him who asks, and you shall, who ask you, and from him who wants to borrow from you, do not turn away. Interesting little insight here, isn't it, from the Lord? He says, you want to get even with people? That's not the way. Eye for an eye, that's not what we want. That's there to keep us from ripping somebody's head off for nothing. Somebody slaps you on the cheek, it's more of an insult. You don't have to go after them, do you? Somebody offers you an insult, what do you want to do? Well, yeah, well, you're a blessed saint of God, aren't you? Verse 40 is the one we really want to look at. If anyone wants to sue you and take away your tunic, give him your cloak also. What is the attitude that we should have here? Hey, man, if it's that big of a deal to you, if it's that big of, if you got to go after me like this and everything, go ahead and have it, man. It's okay. The Lord will give me another one. Somebody wrongs you, somebody cheats you and everything like that. Is it that important that it be dealt with? Sometimes it is. But is it always? You want my tunic, man? Here, take my coat too. It's not worth the strife that it causes, the division and all of that. And it's not, he's not telling us to let people take advantage of us and not do anything, but don't push the issue when it doesn't need to be. Sometimes we like to make bigger issues out of things than what they really are. You want to sue me for my tunic? Really? Is it that important to you? That you need to sue me? That you need to do this? Man, here, have the coat too. It's all right, man. I'll get another one. Whoever compels you to go with them 1 mile, go with them too. This would kind of turn that around the other way on the Christian worker in the situation. You've entered into the agreement with somebody. Hey, I'm going to come and I'm going to do this and this for you. And this is what it's going to cost you. And you enter into that agreement. And you come and you did this and this for you. And hey, by the way, I threw this in. And it's on the Lord. Praise God. Instead of doing the least you can do, do the most that you can do. And that ought to be our attitude in every situation. You deal with that in the workplace and stuff like that. If you've ever been in a supervisory position, you have those people that come and want to do the minimum. What do I have to do? Well, this is what you have to do. Okay, let me know if I start crossing that line because I don't want to do more than I'm supposed to. You know? And you get those that say, hey, man, I'm here. What do you need? I'll do it all. Oh, I did that too. As Christians in our dealing with one another, as brothers and these agreements that we get into, the things that we do, hey, you know what? If you're the one providing the service, go the extra mile. Do it for your brothers and sisters and especially those outside. Let them see that. The sad thing that I've heard a few times from different people in different situations, people that are working and doing businesses and stuff, unbelievers say, you know what, man, I really kind of shy away from hiring Christians. Because they're not all that great. They're not all working. They've always got some reason, some excuse, something for something. I've heard that from people. Guy telling me of another guy that he used to work with and everything. He says, man, it was kind of hard. This guy who was a Christian, he was a believer, and he was always gone, always taken off and not concerned with the job and all that stuff. And he always had something that he had to do. It was always God wanting him to go somewhere or do something. And it was really hard. It was bad in the workplace. It affected those that he worked with in a bad way. And they saw that and went, man. Instead of being there, if you're there, if you've entered into that agreement as an employee, no matter who your employer is, then when you do it and go that extra mile, make a difference in that place. It says to him who asks you, and from him who wants to and wants to borrow from you, do not turn away. Borrowing money is a funny thing, isn't it? You borrow stuff sometimes, that's all right. Borrowing money is a funny thing. And how often I've seen situations over very little, brothers and sisters in Christ that have come to the point where they can't, well, I got to go to a whole other church now. Why? Well, brother so-and-so owes me $20 and he won't give it back. You know? Or whatever. And I've sat down with these people and said, hey, you know what? What was the agreement that you entered into when you did this in the first place? Well, they came and they said they had a need and all that and everything and asked me if I could help them out. All right. And so I gave them the money. And they took care of it. They said, I'll pay you back as soon as I can or when I get the chance and everything. And then what'd you say? No, that's all right. Don't worry about it. Really? Two things. You probably shouldn't say that's all right. Don't worry about it if you were going to insist that they give it back. They make it clear. If it's not a gift, tell them. If you want it paid back by next Friday, tell them. But if it's not in your heart to just give it, then don't. Somebody needs something, somebody gives, they come and they say, hey, can you help me out? Can I borrow this? Yeah, here, man, go ahead. And let it go. Bible tells you, you know, if you do that and they pay you back, good. You're both blessed. If you give it to them and they don't pay you back, well, you're blessed because you had it to give and it's all the Lord's anyhow. Imagine that, brothers and sisters fighting over their father's money. That happens too, doesn't it? If somebody wants something, if you got it, if you can help them, give it to them. If they bring it back, if they pay you back, great, man, that's cool. If not, don't worry about it. Do you get those situations? Yeah, I gave it to them. They never did pay me back and everything. Well, did you make an agreement for them to do that in a certain amount of time? No. Has the Lord left you destitute because of this? Well, no. Do you really need it that bad? Well, no. It's the principle of things. Well, what about the principle of this? About loving your brother and letting it go. All of these things and all that stuff, it comes to business, it comes to finances and all of these things like that. That is one of the areas where Christians can get very carnal very quickly. I've seen the situation oftentimes where somebody's got a place and said, well, you know, brother so-and-so needs a place to live. I told him to come over here with me and we could work out the rent and do everything and get it all figured out later. I said, you know what? Figure it out now. Not later. Figure out now. Before you enter into this, figure it out now what the expectations are so that you can save yourself from strife later. Well, they're a believer. So are you. Figure it out now. Deal with it now. Get it straight now. Put together an agreement that will honor the Lord from the get-go. And it's always good to have that wise brother or sister that's going to seek the Lord to be the third party in that, to be accountable. Don't take it to court. Well, I rented them a room and now they're there and nothing's working out and everything like that, so I'm going to Judge Judy and we're going to sell it right there on TV with everybody. And you go in there and it all looks ridiculous. And the world goes, those are believers? Wow. Verse 8. Now you yourselves do wrong and cheat and do these things to your brethren. There it is. Sometimes in the church, brothers and sisters, taking advantage of one another. Verse 9 says, "Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God." Don't be surprised. Don't be deceived. Don't think that these things are all right just because they're done between brothers and sisters in the church. The unrighteous aren't going to inherit the kingdom of God even if they hang out in the same place in fellowship with believers. Even if they're wolves in sheep's clothing and they got a really good sheep outfit on. Some do. It's not going to make a difference. Don't be deceived that these things are okay just because it's Christians doing it. We've all talked to other believers and heard the place where, "Well, you know I shouldn't be doing this, but I'm saved and I'm covered by grace, so isn't it okay?" No, it's not okay. You know, you look at these things and it says these, and we look at this and we talk about unbelievers and everything, and we know they're not going to inherit the kingdom of God. And it's not all right for those who call themselves Christians to practice these things also. It says, "Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God?" That's pretty plain, isn't it? Doesn't say might, could be, maybe. It says they will not. The unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God. "Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators or idolaters or adulterers or homosexuals or sodomites." None of them. People that practice those lifestyles are not going to inherit the kingdom of God. "Nor thieves." What's a thief? Somebody that takes, what, more than $200 that doesn't belong to them? Or somebody that takes anything that doesn't belong to them? "Nor covetousness." Oh, man, that one? That's hard, isn't it? Because sometimes it's hard to understand where you're crossing that line between, "Oh, I really like that and wish I had one," and getting obsessed with it. But are you driven by the things that you don't have and your desires to have them? "Drunkards." That's plain. "Revilers." "Extortioners." Extortioners comes back to those that take advantage of one another, extorting one another for different reasons. They will not inherit the kingdom of God. Very plain, very simple. Verse 11, "And such were some of you." The first part there, it says, "such were some of you." Very important distinction there. It's not you anymore. If you're saved, if you're a believer, if you're born again, then that's not who you are. That's not what drives your life. That's not what can... Well, it's not part of your makeup anymore. You may have to take some growing up in Christ to figure out how to deal with it and not do it anymore, but that's not who you are. And you can't say that, "Hey, you know what, I've been saved for a long time and everything, and I still do this. I think God's okay with it." Such were some of you. The idea is that you don't do that, you don't act that way, you're not like that anymore. You're not covetous, you're not an extortioner. It says, "But you were washed, but you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God." Verse 11, we can change that word "but" there to "because." "Such were some of you," were some of you, the emphasis on "were," you're not anymore because you were washed. Jesus did that. "Because you were sanctified," He set you apart. You're not in the world, or you're not of the world. You might still be in it, but you're not of it. You're set apart unto Him. "Because you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ." And then the Spirit of our God. Paul dealing with this here in this part of chapter 6, quit acting like the world, church. Quit taking your problems and stuff that you shouldn't be doing anyhow. When you're taking advantage of one another, when you're fighting amongst yourself and butting heads, trying to determine who's right, not what's right. Instead of dealing with that within the body of Christ, where you can find a righteous judgment on these things, trying to discern the will of God in these things and how best to glorify Him and bring unity within the body, going outside to the unrighteous, to those judges, and bringing this out there before them. You will not get a just and righteous judgment from an unbelieving person. He says, seek the will of God in these things and settle it between ourselves here as a church, because we're not like the rest of the world. We're not like that anymore. They are, we're not, because we've been washed by the blood, set apart by Christ, and filled with His Holy Spirit. We are different. And we ought to act that way in all of our dealings. We have no need for brother to go against brother before the courts out there in the world. We ought to be able to deal with it ourselves in here, seeking the will of God. And it's so important for us as believers, if we start out seeking the will of God and keep our eyes on Him, then we will finish up glorifying our Lord. That's what we all want to do, isn't it? Don't take this stuff out in the world. Bring it before a righteous judge and seek the will of God. Amen? Father, we come to You this evening, Lord, and we thank You that You are a righteous judge. And that, Lord, You lead us in the ways that we ought to go. And that we can come together in these times when there's issues between us, as there are, and seek Your will. Come to You and ask, Lord, what would You have us do? Lord, bring peace in this. Bring unity in this, not division and strife. So that You might be glorified, Lord, not just in us, not just in the church, but in the world. So that the world out there can see that the love that we have for one another proves that we are Your disciples, Lord. So that love that we have for one another would draw them in to You, Lord Jesus, not push them away. Thank You, Jesus.